So the general theme of the conference is metaphysics and politics. My title may seem to fit that theme well enough, Aquinas, the Conservationist. Right? Conservationism certainly has a political side to it, and Thomas Aquinas has occasionally been suspected of indulging in metaphysics. But I'm afraid that what I actually have to say is going to be quite one-sided. It's almost entirely metaphysical. That doesn't mean it won't carry political implications. I suppose it will. It will have ethical implications, I think. But about those, I would very strongly recommend a very good article, a superb article, by Marie George of St. John's on Aquinas and environmental ethics. Fine piece. I do think that she and I are very much on the same page, but I want to go a little bit more into the metaphysics of the matter. She's more focusing on the ethics. I won't have anything to say directly about Jacques Maritain, but I will have a few things to say about both the existent and the person. So there's a connection. You may be surprised that I use the word conservationist. I think the more common word now is environmentalist. Really, I have a very simple textual reason for using conservationist. But I think in a way it's also more fitting. At least my sense is that the word environmentalist can carry some associations, kind of extreme associations, which you really wouldn't want to connect with St. Thomas. For instance, Thomas does not think that the whole world is a single animal. You get that in some forms of environmentalism, I think, or a single organism of some kind. Nor, as you all know this very well, but he does not think that irrational animals have rights in the proper sense of the term. He doesn't think that there's any such thing as acting justly or unjustly toward irrational creatures. In fact, as you know, most tellingly, he thinks that no matter how irrational animals act toward us, we can licitly kill them when that's truly useful for us. We can do that. Only rational beings, persons, can be treated justly or unjustly. Later on, I'll come back to why Thomas holds that. We'll see that. But if Thomas is not kind of an extreme environmentalist, neither is, this is an expression I'll use, I'll take it back if I have to, but neither is what he would call, what I would call an extreme personalist. He does not think, as a few personalists have held, that only persons are real, or that only persons have value. Of course, many personalists would not say that either, I'm sure. But there are also kind of less radical forms of personalism that don't fit Thomas's thought. And I'm thinking of one in particular, one comes to mind. I heard it expressed kind of informally at a lecture in Rome a few years ago at my university. The lecturer, who is a professor of some prestige, wished to be considered a follower of John Paul II, and as such, the lecturer said, a Thomistic personalist. During the lecture, it came out that the professor regularly tells students that non-human animals are, and this is a quote, they are nothing but recycled matter, the other animals. Now, I'm not an expert on John Paul II, but I would be a bit surprised if he really held that view. I'd be surprised myself. In any case, I'm very sure that St. Thomas Aquinas does not hold that view. In fact, he would not have said that even about weeds or water or rocks, that they're recycled matter, let alone about the other animals. So I raised an objection. It was a friendly conversation, but I raised an objection, and then I was called a tree hugger for defending the other animals. So I want to do two things in this paper. The first is kind of to push back a little bit in a metaphysical way against I'll call it the recycled matter outlook. And the second will be to show why St. Thomas, even if we might call him a conservationist or a proto-conservationist or something like that, he's not a tree hugger. That is, I want to show why he still has very strong grounds for a special kind of dignity in the sense of a special goodness or lovability that belongs only to persons. I will even try to suggest that the difference which St. Thomas maintains between the dignity of persons and that of other beings is even greater than that which you find in many personalists, surprisingly. And I'm going to base most of my remarks on just one article of the Summa Theologiae, which is the handout. It's not noticed very much, I think. Marie George refers to it, but she doesn't really go into it very much. And I think it's pretty crucial for this whole discussion. The article is from the Treatise on Charity in the Summa Theologiae, the moral part. It belongs to the third question on the virtue, on this virtue. The previous two questions were on the intrinsic nature of charity and on how it is possessed. So the third, which is question 25, is on the things or the realities that fall under charity, what its objects are. Now, Thomas has already explained that charity is essentially friendship with God. So in this question, he doesn't even ask whether charity bears upon God. That's too obvious to even ask. What he first asks in Article 1 of the question is whether charity extends to love of neighbor. And of course he says it does. I won't even go into that. That's also pretty obvious. In the second article he asks whether charity itself is to be loved with charity. Whether you can love charity charitably, so to speak. He says it is. This is going to be interesting for us, so I want to go into this. He says that it is, charity is to be loved with charity, but only in a way, only in a certain sense. Here he invokes a distinction. He says, he goes back to the idea of friendship. Charity is friendship with God. He says friendship involves a twofold love. One is the love for the friend, and that's called love of friendship. But to love someone as a friend means to desire the good for them. And so in some way one also loves the good that one desires for the friend. And that sort of love is called love of concupiscence. And they always go together. But we should notice that, contrary to what the term concupiscence might suggest, this love is not always, by no means, always something bad or opposed to charity. It has a different meaning in this context. In fact, and I think this is not always understood, it need not even have one's own good as its object. It may have the good of another, the good of the friend whom one loves. In another place, speaking of God's love, Thomas makes that point quite explicitly. He says, concupiscimus aliquid et nobis et aliis. We desire something both for ourselves and for others. And it's in this second way that charity itself is loved out of charity. According to charity's love of concupiscence as a good that one wants for one's friends. Out of charity, one wants one's friends to have charity as a good for them. And this same point, Thomas says, applies to other things like happiness and the other virtues. We don't love those things as friends. We love them for our friends. We want them for our friends. We'll come back to this distinction. Then comes the article that I want to focus on whether even irrational creatures are to be loved with charity. Notice he's not asking only about the other animals. The question extends to all irrational creatures, sentient or not, living or not. You might object, some might object to lumping them all together in this way. You know. But of course, it's not that Thomas doesn't know that there are differences there. Right? But for his purpose here, those differences are not important. Now, his basic answer to the question, whether they can be loved with charity, is a flat no. They can't. The love of charity does not and cannot extend to irrational creatures. And he gives three reasons. Two of the reasons lead to the conclusion that we can have no friendship at all of any kind toward irrational creatures. First of all, friends want the good for their friends, but he says we cannot want the good for irrational beings. Why not? Not because they're of different kinds. That's not the reason. We can want the good, say, for angels. Angels are of a different kind too, but we can have friendship with them. It's simply because irrational beings cannot, as Thomas puts it, cannot have the good in the relevant sense of the word have. We can't want them to have the good because they can't have it. He gives a formulation, a very simple formulation of that having. He says, to have a good is to be the master of the use of that good. It's up to you to use it. It's in your power. In another place, he puts it this way. He says, we are said to have that which we can freely use or enjoy as we will. Having something means it's in your power to dispose of it as you see fit. For that, you have to have free decision, free choice. And only rational beings, of course, Fritz Thomas, have free choice. To confirm that, he cites a text by Aristotle on luck. Aristotle says that, properly speaking, only beings that have choice, that decide their own goals, can be called lucky or unlucky, just as only they can be called happy or unhappy. So the idea is that maybe we can, in some way, want non-rational beings to thrive or to flourish. You want a tree to grow and to be beautiful. But we can't really wish them well in the way you wish a person well, any more than they can wish it for themselves. But to love a person, to love someone as a friend, involves wishing them well. This, by the way, is why, you know, the lack of free decision, that's why Thomas thinks that they don't have rights and can't be treated justly or unjustly. A right, a jus, is what belongs or is due to some individual. It's his or hers, it's suum, he says, the individual's own. But other animals can't really own anything. They don't even, for Thomas, they don't really even own their own activities. They do what they are naturally made to do. Their actions, they're more made to act than acting, as he says. They're kind of slavish by nature. The other animals are slavish. Only free beings act for their own sake and by their own decision, their own determination. Only they are masters, owners, to which something can belong or can be due. Thomas's second reason for holding that no friendship is possible with irrational beings is that friends somehow share their lives with each other. They live together. To me, that brings to mind Aristotle's famous definition of a friend as another self. Selfhood is a sort of unity. To be a self is to be one in a strong way. It's to have to be one in being, Aristotle says. For living things, to be is to live, and only living beings obviously can be friends. So, in some sense, to be another self is to share the same life, in some way. But irrational beings, Thomas says, cannot share in human life because human life is life according to reason. I suspect he's thinking of Aristotle's remark in the Ethics that for human beings, living together mostly means sharing words and thoughts, and not, as for cattle, feeding in the same place. Right? For us, living together is more than that. He qualifies that a little bit, saying we might speak of friendship in a metaphorical way with irrational creatures. So we can say that a dog is man's best metaphorical friend, maybe. But if you wanted to be friends with your dog in the proper sense of the word friend, you really would have to live a dog's life, right? And share that with the dog. The final reason why charity does not extend to irrational creatures regards specifically the friendship of charity. He says that consists in sharing together not just in rational life, but in eternal life. And of course, irrational creatures are just not capable of eternal life. Eternal life is the life of God. And in strictly speaking, it is God himself who is his life. To be that capable of God, kapax dei, is proper to intellectual beings, rational beings. In the second objection, Thomas says something related. He says, charity extends to things other than God insofar as they pertain to God. This is the objection. Charity extends to things other than God insofar as they pertain to God. And if the rational creature pertains to God as his image, the irrational creature also pertains to God somehow as a vestige of God. Thomas explained that distinction earlier. He said an image is a thing whose very species, or at least some proper feature of it, is makes it like what it is the image of, right? So the name of that feature applies properly both to the image and the original. So both man and God are rational, not in the univocal sense, but it's still proper. It's analogical, but it's proper. By contrast, a mere vestige is like its original only according to some generic or common feature that shows that it's the original's effect. So an image conveys the very form of the original somehow, whereas a vestige only conveys its causality, he says. Any creature has features that bespeak God's causality, unity in being, form, order to perfection, to an end. And the objection is saying, so by virtue of those features, the creature can fall under charity. But St. Thomas just comes back and says again, well, yeah, that's great, but those features aren't enough to be capable of eternal life. You need the image. You need rational existence. That openness to infinite, to universal good, to universal being, which is the nature of intellect. But the article is not finished yet. That's his basic answer, but it's not finished. Now we come to what really interests me. He says, nevertheless, irrational creatures can be loved out of charity as goods that we want for others, to wit, inasmuch as out of charity we want them to be conserved for the honor of God and the use of men. And God, too, loves them out of charity in this way. We want them to be conserved, volumus eius conservari. That's where I got my title. Thomas's use of that word, I think, is a little bit surprising. I'll come back to that. But first, let me just point out that, in effect, what he is saying is that irrational creatures can be loved out of charity in the way we saw charity itself and beatitude and other virtues can be loved out of charity with that love of concupiscence for our friends. His last remark, that this is how God also loves them, provides confirmation of that, because earlier in his discussion of God's love for all things, that was where he invoked the very distinction between love of friendship and love of concupiscence. And that's how God loves irrational creatures, with love of concupiscence. He says God loves them insofar as he orders them to rational creatures and even to himself, not as though he needs them, but on account of his goodness and for our use. But let's go back to this expression he uses. We want them to be conserved. That may seem a bit odd that he says that for two reasons. First of all, why does he not just say that they are goods, which out of charity we want for God's honor and man's use? Why does he focus on their being conserved? Well, I think it's because their being conserved is nothing other than their continuing in being, and because their being is their most proper and most fundamental perfection. Nothing is more a thing's own than its being. Its being is what makes it, first of all, is the first thing that makes it a good. To want the conservation of irrational creatures is not just to want goods that happen to be connected with them somehow. It's really to want the goods that they themselves are, in a strong sense. But the second reason for wondering why he uses that expression arises from a point that comes out elsewhere, that he's talking about the conservation in being of the natures of the species of things, their kinds, not the individuals, but the kinds. That's what he's really talking about. And that makes it curious because, as I'm sure you know, Thomas holds that the species of things are permanent. They're always there. They're in no danger of going out of existence. Marie George says that it did not occur to Aquinas that a species could go extinct. So you could wonder, can it make sense to speak of wanting something to be the case if you're sure that it cannot not be the case? It has to be that way. Why should you bother to want it to be that way? Well, I think Thomas does think that can make sense, you know. To take the extreme example, he thinks that God wants his own goodness to exist. And of course, it's absolutely impossible that God's goodness not exist. But I think we can say, well, God is happy about that. He's, you know, that gives him more reason for joy, for resting in the possession of the good that he wants, his own good. Also, although Thomas does not think that any species will go extinct before the end of the world, he obviously thinks that the conservation of the species requires a cause. In fact, in most cases, a concurrence of many causes. And he does not think that the extinction of a species is simply impossible, or that the survival of a species is an absolutely necessary thing. He presents it as at least conceivable. For example, he says, quote, our intellect can grasp the essence of a lion or a horse even if all such animals were to be destroyed. So he can conceive the possibility anyway. And I think it's clear that he regards that possibility as real, that is, as having a basis in the natures of the things themselves. Because the way in which the species are conserved is by the ongoing, at least living things, the ongoing generation of new individuals of the species, by individuals that already exist and that eventually pass away. So none of those individuals is a necessary being. And the generation itself is always a contingent process. It can be thwarted in any particular case. And, you know, I think Thomas took the story of Noah's Ark as literal truth, you know. The animals could have been destroyed if it weren't for Noah. Notice, however, that Thomas does not say that we work for the conservation of these creatures. He only talks about wanting their conservation. That's enough for his purpose, which is to bring them in somehow within the range of charity. You know, because charity, love, is primarily in the will. It's only secondarily in the external action, but it's primarily in the will. But I think that Marie George is right when she says that, quote, Aquinas does not realize that we can play a role in safeguarding the integrity of nature, and that it never crossed his mind that we could eradicate a species or that we could disrupt the harmony of nature to any significant extent, either by eliminating species or by disrupting the inanimate natural environment upon which they depend. And I think she's also right to argue that if Thomas had known those things, he would have judged us somehow responsible for conserving the species, insofar as our capabilities and our priorities allow us to do so. And that would be a responsibility rooted in charity. I think that's what we get right here. But let's look a little more closely at why, out of charity, we want these creatures to be conserved. He says it's for God's honor and for our use. It seems to me that right here we have something of an echo of a distinction that you know very well between two senses of the word good. That is, the noble and the useful. And as you know, those are not two species of a genus of good. Rather, they're good by analogy, per prius et posterius. The primary sense is the noble. Things are called noble insofar as, Thomas says, quote, insofar as they have in themselves that on account of which they are desired. They have their own perfection, and that's what makes them desirable. The useful is a derivative sense. A thing is truly useful insofar as it is conducive to some other noble thing. Nothing prevents the same thing from being both noble and useful. Thomas says that moral virtue is like that, being both desirable in itself and conducive to happiness. But the reason why I say that our text echoes that distinction is the language that he employs, simply. The word use, man's use, utilitas, obviously points to the useful. And the word honor points, I think, to the noble. Thomas's word for noble is honestum, which he says means worthy of honor. So in a way, our text is basing the desire for the conservation of irrational creatures on the fact that they are goods that are both useful and noble. Now, you may object to that. You may say what gets in the text, what gets the honor is not the irrational creature, but God. He's the honorable one. But I think here, too, the comparison with moral virtue helps. Thomas says, honor is a certain testimony to the virtue of him who is honored. At the same time, clearly for Thomas, virtue is a noble good. But the nobility of the virtue, the honorability of the virtue and the honorability of the virtuous person are the same thing. And most properly, I think it is the person and not the virtue that gets the honor or is honorable, just as most properly it's the virtuous person who is virtuous. It's not the virtue that's virtuous. The courage is not courageous. It's the soldier who's courageous. Virtue is a quality, an accident, quo est, right? What it qualifies and what it ennobles is its subject, not itself. Of course, irrational creatures are not accidents at all. They're substances, and they do not adhere in God. He's not their subject. But a subject can be denominated by extrinsic things, too, even by subsistent things, so long as the thing has an order to it. So a man is called clothed by a subsistent thing, by his clothing. And the irrational creature is a noble thing, and it belongs to God. It is his. and so it makes him honorable. Obviously, it doesn't do so in the sense that it adds to his nobility, his intrinsic nobility, which is infinite. But it's a kind of likeness of that, a kind of overflow of that, and it makes him honorable to us who don't see his own intrinsic nobility or honorability. But I don't mean to say that only we are, let's say, alive to the goodness of irrational creatures, their nobility. Prior to our appreciation of them, you know, they do have an inclination toward their own being. And that inclination, that due order in things toward the good, is a noble thing too. And that pertains, I mention that because it pertains to the irrational creature's status as a vestige of God. Conveys God's causality. That's the fifth way. We were talking about the fifth way last night. The tendency in things toward their own good displays God, displays God's causality. Of course, that inclination in things is not itself charity, but there's an affinity between that and charity, I think. Thomas does say that in a way all things desire God just by desiring their own perfections. I said that the creature is not an accident. Only subsistent beings are properly called creatures, Thomas says. And only subsistent beings are properly called vestiges of the Trinity as well. But every subsistent is such a vestige, is a vestige of the Trinity. It is so insofar it is one substance with a certain form or species and with a certain order or inclination towards something else. Common to all, for example, is an inclination toward others of their own kind, common to all creatures. Now let me just say a few things about the other motive for wanting creatures to be conserved, which is man's use. As is obvious to anybody who's familiar with Thomas, that use is not confined to bodily needs, though it obviously includes them. But irrational creatures also serve our intellectual and even our spiritual needs in very basic ways. First of all, remember, for Thomas, the proportionate object of the human mind, what it first grasps and in relation to which it grasps everything else, is the nature of a bodily thing. Of course, that also covers us, rational creatures, because we also are bodily things. But the understanding of our own nature and what's distinctive about it is achieved only by comparison and contrast with the others, for Thomas. I think that even comes out, that's part, at least part of the reason why God took Adam to the zoo, right? Shows him the other animals. He names them, he knows, learns their natures, and then he compares them with himself, and he sees they don't quite match up, right? And he needs their helpmate. Moreover, according to Thomas, every kind of thing, no matter how low or humble it is, has some proper perfection of its own, found in no other kind. And the principle or origin of understanding of the understanding of a bodily thing is in the thing itself, it's in the thing's form, which he says is a sort of intelligible light. That's so even though we have to help it, we have to make it actually intelligible by abstracting it from matter and sort of turning the light on, so to speak, so it can manifest itself. So bodily things, irrational creatures, actually perfect our mind. They provide it with knowledge that we are not naturally able to get otherwise. Knowledge of themselves and knowledge of their divine origin. Each has its proper perfection, and each represents the perfection of God in a way that no other does. And this is why, Thomas says, this is why God chose to create so many different kinds of things. Many different natures, and not just personal natures. He teaches that the universe of creatures, though it is not a person, and it includes non-persons, is in a very real way more perfect than the intellectual creature. He says it is so and uses these words, extensively and diffusively. The perfection that is intrinsic to an intellectual creature, even an angel, is only part of the perfection of the whole universe. This is so, even though the intellectual creature has a greater likeness of the divine perfection than the universe does, intensively and collectively, he says. That is, insofar as it is Capax Dei. It goes beyond the whole universe in that capacity for God. But that's a striking thing, isn't it? Our greatest, most ennobling property is absolutely a relation to something else. It's relative to God. And in a way, it's a huge and infinite need that we have for God, not just an absolute perfection that we have in ourselves. And, of course, right there in our relation to God, he's saying, the irrational creature is useful for us, not only by helping to make God known to us, but also by making him honorable to us. We should remember the word honor. We should remember that to honor God, for Thomas, is the proper end, the very point of the virtue of religion. So he's saying that the irrational creatures have a religious role, very, very strong religious role. And for that reason, I think it's quite fitting that the Roman pontiff should show concern for these creatures, you know, for the motive indicated in his encyclical's title, Laudato Si, be ye praised, O Lord. Well, I've said enough, I hope I've said enough to put to rest the recycled matter view. On that view, it sounds like, anyway, the only subsistent apart from persons is matter. The forms would be accidental, coming and going. There would be no real inclination toward conserving the being of any specific kind. That's not Thomistic, certainly. It's closer to some kind of pre-Socratic reduction of things to elements or atoms, or to the Cartesian conception of the body as mere extension and of the other animals as mere machines. But in these last few minutes, I want to argue that Thomas is nevertheless not a tree hugger. Maybe, I think it could seem hard for him to avoid being one, given the value that he clearly does assign to trees and other things. Right? He does say that only persons are objects of charity, only they have rights, and so forth. But can he really explain that? Does his metaphysics really account for the difference? He has that famous statement, you know, that the term person signifies what is most perfect in all of nature, namely that which subsists in a rational nature. But is that enough to make the difference? It puts person on top, what's most perfect in nature, but it on the top of the scale, so to speak, but it's all the same scale. Sounds like they're on the same scale. And even if he does see in intellectual nature the root of that infinity, the capacity for God, it's only a qualified infinity. It's only a capacity. It's not an infinite perfection that we have in ourselves. It's a relation to God's perfection. If we look at the created person absolutely, just in him or herself, we see only a finite perfection, finite being with a finite perfection. And the perfection of the whole, intrinsic to the whole universe, is greater, as I said before. So the really staunch personalist may feel that the true value of the person has really not yet been disclosed or explained. He would want to say that persons and non-persons they have to be shown to be really incommensurable, not on the same scale. there has to be kind of an infinite difference. That's the sense, I think, that the personalist has. And I think at least some personalists would want to say that to account for that difference, we have to go beyond notions like nature and form and substance and that sort of thing. Those are not enough. We have to break out of that kind of metaphysics. We need a richer metaphysics. Well, I think maybe in a sense that's true, but those notions are not enough. But I think that the metaphysics, you might expect me to think this, but I think this, the richer metaphysics, we can find it in Thomas himself. And I think we've already seen it right there in the distinction that he makes between what is fit to be an object of love of friendship and what is fit only to be an object of love of concupiscence. Something is lovable insofar as it's good, and so that amounts to a distinction in ways of being good. I think you can say a lot about that. I just want to remark on how strong this distinction is. So, insofar as persons alone are fit for love of friendship, they are not just more lovable, not just greater goods on the same scale. They're not even just infinitely greater on the same scale. They are good in a different and a more predominant sense of the word good. The word good doesn't have the same meaning said of those two kinds of good. Thomas goes so far as to compare how the two objects, the objects of those two loves differ as goods, that difference between those two kinds of objects of love, to the difference between subsistent things or substances and merely inherent things or accidents as beings. And that, of course, is a difference in the meaning of the word being. It's not just on this, it's not on the same scale. Right? Let me quote that. He said, this is from the Prima Secunda. What is loved with love of friendship is loved without qualification and for itself, while what is loved with love of concupiscence is not loved without qualification and for itself, but for another. For just as an entity, an ens, without qualification, is that which has being, esse, while an entity in a qualified sense is that which is in another, so good which converts with entity is without qualification that which itself has goodness, while that which is the good of another is good in a qualified sense. Now here I don't think we should not confuse what he's calling good for another or the good of another with good being good as a means. That's something else. A means is good only as conducive to some further result, some end, right? But even a genuine end, a noble good can be a good of another in the sense that it's for another to enjoy. That's how happiness and the nobility of virtue and those other things we talked about are goods of another. They're not means to something else, but they're for their subjects to enjoy. It's the person who enjoys being happy, not the happiness. But what I mainly want to stress is that even some subsistent things, the irrational ones, are only goods of another. So the comparison between the goods and the beings or the entities is not a strict symmetry. They're good. They are beings in the primary sense. They are subsistent things, but they are goods only in a secondary sense. Persons and non-persons can have a common mode of being or be entities in the same sense. They are composite substances, human persons and the others, but they have radically different modes of goodness and are good in diverse, merely analogical senses, with the primary sense applying to persons. Now, you might say that that's just an ad hoc response to the request for an account of the special dignity or value of persons. Just sort of bring that in to show that we can speak of the difference. But I think it dovetails quite well with something that Thomas explains very early in the Prima Pars. He says that even though being, entity, and good are convertible. Everything which is good is a being, and everything which is a being is good. Nonetheless, the primary sense of entity and the primary sense of good are not convertible, he says. And that's not absurd, because the words are not synonymous, after all. There he's talking about goodness, I think, strictly as taken in relation to the nature of the thing that's called good, as when we call a horse a good horse. So there the point would be that what makes a horse a being without qualification, what makes it simply exist, is its substantial being. But its substantial being only gives it some goodness, not all the goodness that a horse ought to have according to its nature. It needs health, it needs strength, it needs a certain size, and so forth. But I think he's saying that even to be an unqualifiedly good horse is not the same as to be unqualifiedly good, period. That belongs only to what is lovable with love of friendship. And that has to be a person. Persons and non-persons can be entities in the same sense, but they are not good or lovable in the same sense. The lovability of persons is not on the same scale with that of other entities. Only persons are huggable, I think we can say. Only persons are huggable. But to conclude, what is especially typical of Thomas, I think, is that he does not have to disparage trees or horses or dogs in order to exalt persons. That's very typical of Thomas, I think. He doesn't have to disparage nature in order to exalt grace, or to disparage philosophy in order to exalt theology, or to disparage the creature in order to exalt the creator, on the contrary. To Thomas's eyes, the non-rational part of creation is great, it's fascinating, and it's very noble. And I think, on the other hand, he would undoubtedly say that its value is in no way enhanced by merely denying that it exists for us and for its maker, right? So you're not denying that value by saying it's for us, by saying it's not an ultimate end, because it simply cannot be loved as friends are loved. It can't be. Even if you would like it to be, they cannot be other selves to us, those creatures. But they can and they should be loved for ourselves and for our friends. And if we really do want them to be conserved, we should be glad, very glad, to have a friend who can always do something about that. Thank you very much.